In het bejaardentehuis in Berwick, Australië, woont Millie, de oudste survivor van kamp Vught. We bezoeken haar en haar familie. De zonen vertellen ons hun familieverhaal van de Holocaust.
Er was in onze familie echt nooit een gevoel dat iets verschrikkelijks is gebeurd daarvoor. Het was gewoon een hele normale opbrenging. We hebben een zaak gebouwd, een mooie zaak. We hebben een hele goede leven gehad en ik kan echt zeggen dat er helemaal geen, dat het gevoel dat trauma was, dat hadden we nooit in onze gedachten. Drie van de vier zijn niet uit de oorlog gekomen. Tantes en oma's, mijn broer, mijn vader, zijn twee broer en zus, allemaal dood in de oorlog. Maar als kleine kinderen, daar denk je niet zoveel aan. Hè? En alleen maar als je een beetje ouder wordt, dan ga je er meer over denken. En ik denk dat Jules, toen wij hem ontmoeten, hij heeft dat ons wakker gemaakt over al dat. Dat wij meer interesse hebben ingekomen. En toch dat we nooit iets zouden weten als we niet zo voor de boeken dat Jules had geschreven.
He wrote several books, and Paul has probably a better knowledge than I, yeah. But the books have been translated into many languages, and this one in particular, called Inside the Gates, tells the story of Shul and his whole journey from the time that he went to Westerbork and then to Sobibor and survived a number of concentration camps quite an amazing and disturbing piece of literature. And he wrote other books and also was involved in what I believe is called a Stichting Sobibor. And to the extent where he instigated publications such as this, which gives the names of the people by train, by date, etc., etc., and these little pink slips are all Rubenses and Schelvis and Arens and all the family names. So it really is quite, quite disturbing, emotional, Yeah, so we're very, and this lady that we still have with us today, she experienced all those things.
Yeah. Waar was Millie toen Jules in het kamp was? Het
eerste jaar was Millie nog thuis. Yeah. En toen, en zij was eigenlijk een jaar na Jules opgenomen. Millie was met haar moeder, al de hele oorlog samen met haar moeder. Millie en haar moeder waren diamantenslijpers. En een diamantenslijper is een vak dat niet iedereen kent. Het is een hele bepaalde vak. En de Duitsers wouden die mensen hebben na de oorlog. Want natuurlijk, de Duitsers zouden winnen. Ze hadden dan een goede medewerking met Zuid-Afrika, waar al die diamanten van toe kwamen. Zo, ja, de Joodse diamantslijpers moesten leven.
Only a few months ago, my wife and I visited our grandchildren who were overseas, but we went through and spent 3 weeks in Holland, which I still feel very Dutch because of my heritage. I had been to Holland on a number of occasions, but it's been 20 years since I was there. But I made, and since becoming aware of the information that Shul has made available to us, I made a point of finding out more for myself and trying to visualize what my parents were subjected to. The first port of call was to where we were born, in Zetelgenbosch. And then I started asking lots of questions and became aware of the fact that there are several, or quite a number of concentration camps or holding camps in Holland. and that they, from there, the people, namely Jews and other people that the Germans wanted to incarcerate, were sent to Westerbork in Holland, and that's of course where most people were transported to before they were sent off to the extermination camps. So my mother and Shul will have been in Westerbork at some point in time, maybe together or maybe not. But what was amazing is that I was trying to visualize what happened in 1942 when the Nazis came into Zaterdam-Bosch, and I actually visited the house where we lived, and where she was taken to a camp in Vught. Now Vught is all of 5 kilometers away from Zaterdam-Bosch, so to try and imagine what it would have been like to be picked up by truckloads of invading people, taken 5 kilometers and put into a camp was just something that I could never comprehend, but I was able to visualize it. So we went to Camp Vught, and I did bring material back and learned a lot about Camp Vught and how it operated. It was there, I don't know for how long, but her name was inscribed in a memorial there. I spoke with the people there and I told them about my mother and told them that she was still alive. And as it turns out, Millie is the oldest surviving person from Camp Vught today, which again is just a miracle. And of course, from there, she went to Westerbork with the mother, Westerbork, we visited that as well. And it was just quite eye-opening, and especially having read the books from Shul, which was in real time, and seeing Westerbork some 70 or 80 years later and visualizing what these people went through, it was enormously emotional to see where these people were held, the trains, the guards. It's something that I'm glad I've seen. And we count our blessings every day as children and descendants of our parents.
In het bejaardentehuis in Berwick, Australië, woont Millie, de oudste survivor van Kamp Vught. We bezoeken haar en haar familie. De zonen vertellen ons hun familieverhaal van de Holocaust.
Er was in onze familie echt nooit een gevoel dat iets verschrikkelijk is gebeurd daarvoor. Het was gewoon een hele normale opbrenging. We hebben een zaak gebouwd, een mooie zaak. We hebben een hele goede leven gehad. En ik kan echt zeggen dat er helemaal geen... Dat het gevoel dat trauma was, dat hadden we nooit in onze gedachten. 3 van de 4 zijn niet uit de oorlog gekomen. Tantes en oma's, mijn vader zijn 2 broer en zus, allemaal dood in de oorlog. Maar als kleine kinderen, daar denk je niet zoveel aan. Hè? En alleen maar als je een beetje ouder wordt, dan ga je er meer over denken. En ik denk dat Jules, toen wij hem ontmoeten, hij heeft dat ons wakker gemaakt over al dat. Dat wij meer interesse hebben ingekomen. En toch dat we nooit iets zouden weten als we niet zo voor de boeken dat Jules had geschreven.
He wrote several books and Paul has probably a better knowledge than I. Yeah. But the books have been translated into many languages and this one in particular called Inside the Gates tells the story of Jules and his whole journey from the time that he went to Westerbork and then to Sobibor and survived a number of concentration camps and quite an amazing and disturbing piece of literature. And he wrote other books and also was involved in what I believe is called a Stichting Sobibor. And to the extent where he instigated publications such as this, which gives the names of the people by train, by date, etc., etc. And these little pink slips are all Rubenses and Schelvis and Arens, and all the family names. So it really is quite disturbing, emotional, so we're very, and this lady that we still have with us today, she experienced all those things.
Yeah. Waar was Millie toen Jules in het kamp was?
Het eerste jaar was Millie nog thuis. Yeah. En zij was eigenlijk een jaar na Jules opgenomen. Millie was met haar moeder, al de hele oorlog samen met haar moeder. Millie en haar moeder waren diamantenslijpers. En een diamantenslijper is een vak dat niet iedereen kent. Het is een hele bepaalde vak. En de Duitsers wouden die mensen hebben na de oorlog. Want natuurlijk, de Duitsers zouden winnen. Ze hadden dan een goede medewerking met Zuid-Afrika, waar al die diamanten van toe kwamen. Zo, de Joodse diamantslijpers moesten leven.
Only a few months ago, my wife and I visited our grandchildren who were overseas, but we went through and spent 3 weeks in Holland, which I still feel very Dutch because of my heritage. I had been to Holland on a number of occasions, but it's been 20 years since I was there. But I made, and since becoming aware of the information that Jules has made available to us, I made a point of finding out more for myself and trying to visualize what my parents were subjected to. The first port of call was to where we were born, in Sertogenbosch, and then started asking lots of questions and became aware of the fact that there are quite a number of concentration camps or holding camps in Holland, and that they, from there, the people, namely Jews and other people that the Germans wanted to incarcerate, were sent to Westerbork in Holland, and that's of course where most people were transported to before they were sent off to the extermination camps. So my mother and Jules will have been in Westerbork at some point in time, maybe together or maybe not. But what was amazing is that I was trying to visualize what happened in 1942 when the Nazis came into Sertogenbosch. And I actually visited the house where we lived, and where she was taken to a camp in Vught. Now Vught is all of 5 kilometers away from Sertogenbosch. So to try and imagine what it would have been like to be picked up by truckloads of invading people, taken 5 kilometers and put into a camp, was just something that I could never comprehend, but I was able to visualize it. So we went to Camp Vught, and I did bring material back and learned a lot about Camp Vught and how it operated. It was there, I don't know for how long, but her name was inscribed in a memorial there. I spoke with the people there and became and I told them about my mother and told them that she was still alive. And as it turns out, Millie is the oldest surviving person from Camp Vught today, which again is just a miracle. And of course, from there, she went to Westerbork with the mother, Westerbork, we visited that as well. And it was just quite eye-opening, and especially having read the books from Schul, which was in real time, and seeing Westerbork some 70 or 80 years later and visualizing what these people went through, it was enormously emotional to see where these people were held, the trains, the guards. It's something that I'm glad I've seen, and we count our blessings every day as children and descendants of our parents.
In het bejaardentehuis in Berwick, Australië, woont Millie, de oudste survivor van Kamp Vught. We bezoeken haar en haar familie. De zonen vertellen ons hun familieverhaal van de Holocaust.
So, Millie was gestuurd naar een paar kampen. En haar verhaal is in mijn, ik denk, verschrikkelijk. Maar Millie deed precies het verschil, de opposite to what Schul deed. Zij heeft nooit een woord over dat kunnen praten. Ze heeft dat altijd binnengehouden. Wij wisten daar niks van. Maar ongeveer 20 jaar geleden, mijn oom in Curaçao, mijn vaders broer, heeft mij een brief gestuurd dat mijn moeder aan hem gestuurd een paar weken nadat zij was bevrijd. En ze was bevrijd en er was 6 weken in een Rode Kruiskamp in Zweden. En daar is ze weer toegekomen. En die brief vertelt ons heel veel. Yeah. So the letter says this. This is to my father's brother, who had actually escaped to Australia. He was living in Brisbane, and somehow she found that out. This is dated Gothenburg, Sweden, the 7th of August, 1945. After 3 months in Sweden, so she'd been there for 3 months already, I said 6 weeks, I received a letter from Ruth. Ruth was my father. I'm so happy and lucky that you are both healthy. My mother and I arrived in Sweden on May 3rd, saved from the German claws. As you may know, we were in Bergen-Belsen, where it was at least bearable. So she thought Bergen-Belsen was okay, compared to the last 5 months of the war. Mother and I were sent to another camp for those months. There we had to work in an ammunition factory 600 meters under the ground. Very unhealthy conditions, as you may expect. In the mornings, we were woken at 3 a.m. and made to stand to attention for 2 hours for no real reason. Then marched for 2 hours under the ground through small, sometimes very narrow tunnels with rails, with guards yelling and pushing. We had to work till 6 p.m. in the evening on 3/4 of a liter of cool water. When we returned to our prison at night, we had a lump of bread shoved in our hands with a beating to go with as well. Because of the bombers, the lights were then usually turned off and we had to go to bed in the pitch dark. With the two of us in one bed, 3 beds against each other in 4 square meters. 12 people could sleep and there were about 200 people in one cage. The hygiene was terrible. No water, no soap, no towels, never clean clothes. We were so filthy and totally covered in lice. Imagine, Sol, we never expected to come out alive. It was a miracle that my mother and I never contacted a disease. In the winter months, we only had a singlet and a summer dress. No socks, no pants, and either broken or completely no shoes. We were lucky that in the salt mine it was warm. Because of this, But because of this, we had a terrible thirst, and we were not allowed to drink just out of pure meanness. When the Allied forces came closer, we were forced to take flight, and this was the worst. For 14 days, we were transported in cattle wagons. A total of 5,000 people were transported on the train, with 220 people per wagon. We were barely able to stand, let alone sit or lie down, and no meals at all. Can you understand that? The first few days, a small piece of bread, then one potato or a handful of raw macaroni. Then the last 3.5 days, nothing. Hundreds of people died because people went mad of thirst and hunger and literally murdered each other. It was actually indescribable, and you cannot even begin to imagine it if you were not there to see it. In Holland, there's still nothing to buy, but I do not have to worry about that for the next few years. Mother only weighs 80 pounds and I 98 pounds, but we are gaining weight. We hope to go to Holland next week, maybe by flying machine. My brother Jules has returned from Poland after nearly two years. One chance in 100,000. Of the 34,000 Dutch Jews who were shipped to Sobibor, only 18 survived. Did you ever think that you would ever be in Australia, Sol? Please come back to Holland as soon as you can. I really miss you. I want to see you again. Now that I've heard from Ruud, I'm so impatient and nervous. I just can't wait. We'll get married as soon as possible, and I would think it's such a disappointment if you were not there. If you write back to me, send a letter to the, gives an address in Amsterdam. Dear Sol, keep strong. My mother sends her love and a huge hug from your sister-in-law, Millie.
What impacted you the most?
The three weeks in a cattle truck. 3 weeks. You know, if I lock you in the laundry with no television for a day, think about it. You know, 3 weeks, couldn't stand, couldn't sit, just squashed in like sardines into a can, and then people dead all around you all the time for 3 weeks. Nothing, I can't go a day without eating. Yeah.
The one thing that really I thought of often was what if? And when I say what if, is what if my parents, my mother wasn't a diamond cutter? What if my father hadn't survived the war? What if they hadn't have decided to come to Australia? And it's an intriguing question I ask myself every day. If I'm having a bad day, I just think of what my parents endured, and it's quite something that we are mindful of. And we're proud to be Dutch. We're proud to be of Jewish heritage, and we're very fortunate that our children, which we have imparted our story with, are also learning and learning about it, so that their children won't forget either. 6 million Jews died. There were 60 million people died during World War II. That's incomprehensible. And they survived.